Everybody, it's a great pleasure to introduce Igor Czalek from Rzeszów University in Poland, who is kindly visiting us and will tell us about quantum devices and also the work that is being done at his university. Igor prepared some copies of review article that he wrote on quantum devices. There are some paper copies here if you are very curious, you can grab them now or a bit later, but these of course will also be made available electronically so everybody will access it. So thank you very much, Igor, for coming. And
thank you. Thank you very much for introduction. So, ladies and gentlemen, it is my great pleasure to be here and to have the possibility to share with you some my modest knowledge concerning quantum devices. And at first, I would like to say a couple of words about my city. Rzeszów is in the southeast part of Poland, just near the Ukrainian and Slovakian borders, about 80 kilometers apart. It's a small city in comparison with Lisbon because we have only 200,000 inhabitants. But nevertheless, this city is extremely fast-developing city, and it is the center of Polish aviation valley. We have a great many different enterprises involved in the in this business around this city. In the city, this is a great enterprise which repair and construct the engines for almost all types of civil aircrafts. Near Rzeszów, there is also some small city where the helicopters are assembled, and these helicopters are not only for the Polish army, but only for the other armies of NATO. It obtained the city rights under the reign of Kazimierz the Great in 1343, and this gentleman rebuilt this city after the great fire in 15th century. This is our castle. In the time of Austrian-Hungarian Empire, it was the jail here, but now it's the headquarters of the courts. This is the marketplace with the city hall in the background. And this is the new building of our faculty of mathematics and natural sciences. This is the main entrance. This is a view from inside, and this giant egg is the conference hall. There are 300 sitting place there. And some of my colleagues in front of the main building. So now let us start our lecture. And at first, I would like to give a definition. What does it mean, quantum devices? So apparently, quantum devices, these are the devices which can be described, or better to say, whose mode of operations can be understood only in the framework of quantum mechanics. We are the witnesses now of an ever diminishing, ever shrinking the sizes of devices. So the natural question is why it is so. As in many other fields of people activities, the main driving force is money, unfortunately. Why it is so? Because everyone would like to give away less money as it is only possible, right? Some years ago, I have read the essay of a great American statesman and a scientist, Benjamin Franklin. His essay entitled "How to Make Money Plenty in Every Man's Pocket." And the answer was to give away less than you have. So, if the sizes of the devices ever shrinking, it means that these devices consume less electricity, and in the consequence, you pay less money. But it's not the only reason. The other reason is simply that some fields of human activities would be impossible without extremely small devices. For example, space exploration will be absolutely impossible without that. All this adventure with new technological revolution started by the activities of these three gentlemen, John Bardeen, William Brettain, and William Shockley. They invented a classical transistor, and in order to understand how this transistor operates, from quantum mechanics, we should know only the simple fact that the semiconductor has two bands, conduction band and valence band. After that, we can forget all quantum mechanics and consider the electron movement within the piece of a semiconductor just in classical terms. But there are, of course, situations when we are cannot understand how the device operates without knowing quantum mechanics. These three slides illustrate the tendency. Here we have the time scale and the integration level of memory chips during 15 years. It was predicted that the integration level doubled every 18 months, but this number was superseded from 1993. This slide shows us the development of integrated circuits, or better to say, the atoms, the number of atoms which are needed to process one bit of information. In 16th, it was 10 to 19. Why it is so? Because this number of atoms are in the small piece of a semiconductor, which is the basis of a classical transistor. But now this number goes down, and now we are able to manipulate even the single electrons. On the right, we have the energy which is needed to per one logical operation. In 16th, it was 10 to 8 picojoule. Pico means 10 to minus 12, as you remember. And in 2020, it will be 10 to minus 8 picojoule. Maybe even 10 years ago, we were somewhere here. But now we are in the realm of quantum devices. Another interesting question is, I already told you that in most of the cases, quantum devices are very small devices. But not always, because sometimes the quantum mechanic effects reveal themselves in macro scale. And later on, I'll tell you something about that. But now, let us consider the characteristic lengths which can characterize the different types of devices. So, if we are talking about quantum mechanics, it means that sometimes the sizes of the devices are so small that it can be compared with the de Broglie wavelengths in metals or in semiconductors. There is some difference between de Broglie lengths in metals and in semiconductors, because the number of electrons in the metals, which are free to move, are much greater than a semiconductor. That is why the de Broglie wavelength is a bit greater. So if you remember, de Broglie wavelength is equal to h over v, where v is the electron velocity. In the metal, very often we can suppose that the electron mass is equal to electron mass in vacuum, while in case of a semiconductor, we should substitute N by M asterisk, where the M is the effective mass of the electron in a semiconductor. In a semiconductor, and in more general, in the solid state, we have no access to the electron mass. We can measure the electron mass within the piece of a semiconductor or a metal. It's obvious. The only thing which we can measure is the so-called dispersion relation. It means the dependence of energy over, let it be only one direction, only one axis here, over k. So sometimes the conduction band has a complicated structure, but it is useful to remember that effective mass is proportional to the second derivative of energy over k to minus 1. It means that the greater this curvature of the surface is, the smaller is the effective mass. That is why, for example, in gallium arsenide, it is about 0.01 electron mass in vacuum. That is why the De Broglie length in a semiconductor can be greater than in a metal. These are the characteristic distances by means of which we can characterize some types of quantum devices. And you can see that in a Hall regime, this distance is macroscopic. It is about 1 millimeter. It means that even in a comparatively big piece of matter, quantum mechanical effects can reveal themselves. This is an example of a structure which is composed of aluminium gallium arsenide, which is doped by donors. And we have here the gallium arsenide, which is doped by acceptors. I should add some words about it. When we speaking about quantum devices, very often we use some synonym: low dimensional. Structures. What does it mean, low dimensional structures? In what sense they are low dimensional? In most of the cases, it means that the movement of electron is restricted in one or two or even three dimensions. In this case, we cannot describe the electron motion by means of quasi-momentum, because the energy of electron is quantized. So we have three possible situations. When the movement of the electron is restricted only in one direction, we have something which is called quantum well or two-dimensional electron gas. The acronym for two-dimensional electron gas is, I'm sorry, 2DEG, two-dimensional electron gas. It means that the electron movement is limited, is restricted in one direction, but let it be Z direction, okay? So here we have X and Y, and in the plane, which is perpendicular to this axis, the electrons can move freely. That is why we call it two-dimensional electron gas, because we have only two components of quasi-momentum. But if we restrict the electron motion in two dimensions, let it be L, W, and D. So if W is of the order of D and both of them are much smaller than L, we have something which is called quantum wire. And if the electron movement is restricted in three directions, we have something which is called quantum dot. All of these types of structures are used to produce quantum devices. But historically, the first example of a two-dimensional electron gas was this structure. In the interface between these two materials, you see that aluminium gallium arsenide is a dielectric, while gallium arsenide, pure gallium arsenide, is the semiconductor. So if this material is doped by N materials and this one by acceptors, in the interface, in the very thin layer here, the two-dimensional gas arises. Why it is so interesting and important to deal with such structure? Simply because the mobility is the characteristic which, by means of which we can characterize the ability of electrons to move. In three-dimensional gallium arsenide, for example, the mobility is about 8,500 centimeters square by over volt times seconds. In two-dimensional electron gas, the mobility reaches even 1,000,000 centimeters square over volt per second. It means that the frequency of our signals goes up and our computers can operate faster. I think that at first it would be useful to consider some general situation, how the transport in low-dimensional structures, electron transport, I mean, looks like within the semiconductor. And later on, having such a basis, we can go further and we will be able to understand how other quantum devices work. So in a three-dimensional situation, we have a very complicated movement of the electrons within the semiconductor. There is a scattering, right? And there is something which we call drift velocity. If we apply to the piece of a material an electron field. If we have here some battery and we have here some electric field, then the drift velocity arises. But what does it mean, drift velocity? It's a very interesting question. It does not look like that. The electrons, all the electrons, go just like the soldiers during the parade. It's nothing of the kind. The electrons moving in different directions over the Fermi surface. But if we apply the electric field to the sample, there is a little shift in the reciprocal space. And this little shift means current. And the drift velocity is responsible to the current. In order to guess which is the difference between these two velocities, later on, I'll show you how to calculate the Fermi velocity. But right now, I simply tell you that in most of the cases, in the case of a two-dimensional electron gas, drift velocity is about 10 to 7 centimeters per second, while drift velocity is only about 2 to 4 or 2 to 5 at most centimeters per second. This is a difference. So if we depict here how the Fermi velocity looks like in two-dimensional electron gas, we can imagine something like a sphere. Most of the electrons which take part in the current are only in very thin layer in the vicinity of Fermi quasi-momentum. And what does it mean, drift velocity? It simply means a small shift towards the electric field. It looks like that. This difference is nothing else but, or better to say, because we are in the reciprocal space, Kf minus K, which correspond to for dd. How to calculate the mobility, which is a very important characteristic of a quantum devices, it's not only quantum devices, even in a classical transistor. We have two possibilities. I mean, changes of the momentum of the electron in time due to scattering and due to applied electric field. So the question is, well, what is the relation between them? I would like to appeal to your imagination. What do you think about it? Are they equal, or some of them greater or smaller than other? How do you mind?
Scattering, the left side is much bigger.
Not exactly, because let us imagine what would be if the changes, or better to say the derivative of a momentum would be greater than this one. It means that any current would be impossible because all the electrons simply were braked all the time. But if this term would be greater, it means that electrons would be accelerated to greater and greater velocity. So the only way out is to say that they are equal. And after very, very simple manipulations, when we can arrive to this very simple formula, which describes the electron. So this is the simple formula for electron velocity. But now we are going to the realm of quantum mechanics. So the dynamics of electron in a conduction band can be described by this equation. This equation is very similar, better to say, it resembles in some sense the Schrödinger equation, but it in fact is not the Schrödinger equation because this psi function here, wave function, is a smooth variant of a wave function. In which sense? In that sense that we are neglected the very sharp and the fast changing of a wave function in the vicinity of an individual atom. So we are interested in electron movement within the sample. So in some sense, these electrons are free to move. That is why we are interested in some kind of a smooth variant of a wave function. A here is a vector potential. And what else? And this term describes us different kinds of changing of a potential within the sample. For example, if we have interface between aluminium gallium arsenide and gallium arsenide, the potential which arises in the interface can be described by means of this potential. We are searching for the solution in this form because it corresponds to the free movement of electron in XY plane, while in Z direction the energy is quantized. Here we have corresponding dispersion relation. Epsilon sub n here is nothing else but the levels of quantization within for example, two-dimensional electron gas. Again, some manipulations you can find something like this in every popular textbooks. It's important to calculate now the number density of states. It's a very important characteristic of two-dimensional electron gas, the density of states. And in a few minutes, I'll show you how important this characteristic is. But at first, we should calculate the total number of states with the energy less than the sum E. We should remember also that in a plane perpendicular to the Z axis, we have something which is called periodical boundary conditions. What does it mean? It means that if the sizes for the sample in XY direction is great enough, so there is no any there is some difference, of course, but we always neglected this difference between one end and another. Let's suppose that I have here some heavy hammer, right? And simply push it here. So if there is any signal here, except sound, of course, there is no, right? So if we are within this sample, we can assume or we can imagine that there is nothing special are on both sides of a sample. That is why we can simply glue them together. This is the physics of periodic boundary conditions. So in this way, we can calculate the total number of states, and then we can calculate this is the total number of states in two-dimensional electron gas, and this is the density of states. And you can see that here we have the prefactor, right, which is great. That is why two-dimensional gas is so useful, because many processes are described in quantum mechanics, in framework of quantum mechanics, we can describe by means of a density of states. So if we have the great density of states, it means that, for example, the probability of absorption, the probability of emission of light is greater. That is why semiconductor lasers, for example, or our diodes, right? Just like in this laser, right? Because in case of a three-dimensional electron gas, the density of states are denoted by NE. Very often in the literature, it is denoted by D. Density, right? Looks like that, and it is proportional to the square root of energy. While in case of a two-dimensional electron gas, Look at this formula. We have something like this. That is why the two-dimensional gas is so useful and important. Another interesting question is the distribution of electrons within the sample. So it's a famous Fermi distribution, but in case of low-dimensional structures, we have two extreme limits. The first one, which correspond to great temperature, and this one. And the difference between them are striking. You see that in case of this case is called degenerate electron gas, and in this case we have a distribution function like a stepwise function. Fermi distribution function in case of three-dimensional sample looks like this in case of zero temperature. The sense of a distribution function is this. This is the probability to find quantum object with a given energy, right? This is equal here to 1. And this point, it is called Fermi energy. In case of a non-zero temperatures, we have something like this. This point corresponds to the probability 1.5, and we have some tail in this distribution. In case of a two-dimensional electron gas, we have something like this. We also have the step-like distribution. And by means of this, we can calculate the number of electrons, and then we can calculate the current. This formula shows us how the Fermi wave vector looks like. And we can calculate the Fermi velocity, which is proportional to the square root of concentration. But please remember, in the case of two-dimensional electron gas, concentration is measured in the units of centimeter to minus 2. And Fermi velocity, as I told you previously, is about 10 to 7 centimeters per second. What about characteristic lengths? De Broglie wavelengths on the Fermi surface is equal to the electron concentration to minus 1.5. And if we assume such concentration, which is typical for gallium arsenide, for example, two-dimensional gas in gallium arsenide, then the Fermi wavelength, which is about 35 nanometers. The next important characteristic is the mean free path. I think that you are familiar with this notion, right? So I simply skip this slide, and again we come back to the to this equation, which is called effective mass equation, because we have now here the or better to say, in some sense, we neglect the complicated structure of inner potential and simply take into account the discontinuity of a conduction band. At first, let us consider the situation when the magnetic... Just a moment. Okay, we choose this gauge, right? And after some manipulations, we can get this equation, which is nothing else but the harmonic, quantum harmonic oscillations, right? That is why. It's a very interesting question. So we suppose that that the electron movement is restricted not only in z direction but in some sense in y direction also. What does it mean? It means that we have a slab, or better to say, the layer which contains the two-dimensional electron gas, and let it be the length of the sample. So let it be the direction, and the size of the sample in the direction is d. Let it be w, for example, here. This is y direction. This is x direction. So we already know that electron is quantized in this direction because d is the order of a Fermi wavelength. What about w, or the potential with respect to y direction? Frankly speaking, nobody knows how it looks like. But we can suppose, because it's the most simple assumption, that it is proportional to y squared. Then we immediately get the quantum harmonic oscillations, quantum harmonic oscillator, and we are able immediately to write down the solution. And the solution is very well known, and the in every textbook in quantum mechanics, you can find this formula. This is the Hermite polynomials. Hermite, after the great French mathematician Charles Hermite. But in French, H is not pronounced, so we call this gentleman Hermite. He was indeed very, he was brilliant mathematician. So he dealt with such problem many years before the quantum mechanics arose. But we call this solution after him. So this is the energy structure of two-dimensional electron gas in the magnetic field. So we have here K, and we have here something like this, right? The numbers 1, 2, 3, it's the quantum numbers which enumerate the sequential quantum levels in magnetic field. We include the magnetic field a little bit later. This quantization is only due to some restrictions of electron movement in y direction. So I am awfully sorry for that. It's only electrical sum bands. It means that we have space quantization somewhere here. We have space quantization due to restriction of electron movement in z direction. But these numbers 1, 2, 3 enumerate electric subbands. Now let us suppose that u is equal to zero. It means that the electrons are moving freely in y direction, but we have the magnetic field here. And again, we have nothing else but the quantum harmonic quantum oscillator, and the solution is also very well known. But the difference, this quantization is called Landau quantization. Landau quantization. After a Russian physicist Lev Landau, who considered the electron motion in the external magnetic field for the first time in the 30s of the 20th century. And the difference between these two electric subbands and the Landau levels is this. You see that there is no any K dependence, right? But the mathematics in the background is the same. There is no any dispersion relation. There is no any dependence on K. We simply can enumerate these levels by means of integers. And the difference is this. In case of electric subbands, we have dispersion relation, while here we have no any. And now let us take into account both electric subbands due to space quantization in y direction and Landau quantization. After some manipulations, we can reduce this problem also to the quantum harmonic quantum oscillator and immediately have the solution. Omega C0 is the sum of a cyclotron frequency and some effective frequency which correspond to the stiffness of the potential in y direction. And this the picture illustrates how this looks like if we involve magnetic external magnetic field. Now the next question is low field magnetic resistance. The classical dynamics of electron in external electric and magnetic field can be described by means of Newton's second law, and we can introduce here such matrices which describe the electron movement in XY plane. Rearranging this formula, we can express the conductivity in terms of mobility. This is the classical Hall effect. What does it mean? We have this slab of a semiconductor, which is put into the external magnetic field, and due to Lorentz force, the electrons are the trajectory of electrons are distorted. The trajectories are distorted and. We have here some surplus of minuses, and here surplus of pluses. So we have a field which can be measured. And a resistivity tensor is defined by the next relations. And you can see that in the framework of a Drude model, of a classical model, the longitudinal resistivity is proportional to the conductivity to minus one, which can be for forecast, which is obvious. And we have another formula for transverse resistivity, and you can see that it is proportional to the magnetic field. But what people observe carrying out the experiments with a two-dimensional electron gas. This is the example of a sample which was used during this measurement. And after some manipulations, when we can have a very simple formula, and we come to the integer quantum Hall effect, which was observed and discovered for the first time by Klaus von Klitzing, Nobel Prize laureate. And what is interesting here? You see that for the small magnetic field, comparatively small magnetic field, the longitudinal resistivity behaves just like it was predicted by Drude model. And the same is concerned if the transversal resistivity is concerned. You know, for the small magnetic field, it is linearly proportional to the magnetic field. But after that, something different happens. You see that there are some oscillations, while transversal resistivity becomes to be quantized in terms of H over electron charge to square. So now our aim is to explain what is going on here. At first, you heard back to the formulae which describe the resistivity and the conductivity in terms of Drude model, but we should pay our attention on this fact that sometimes this condition is fulfilled. And it means that longitudinal components of sigma of conductivity and resistivity are in direct rather than inverse proportion to one another. It's an important fact, and my advice is to remember that. Now, we should calculate the current which flows within the sample. We should take into account the velocity of each mode. Remember, the energy of electrons are quantized. So we call these states modes. Why it is so? Because it's very similar to the electromagnetic modes, for example, in a resonator, in a laser, for example. That is why in the literature, these quantized states are often called modes. So we should calculate the number of modes which are responsible for the current. But please remember, due to Pauli principle, only the electrons which are in nearest vicinity of Fermi level, only those electrons are responsible for the current. Because all other states are occupied, right? So if we apply here the electric field, we simply it leads to appearing of some holes under the Fermi level and appearing of some small numbers of electrons up the Fermi level. Only those electrons are responsible for the current. So, and above all, they are quantized. So there are different modes which are responsible for the current. So we should calculate the number of modes, take into account the distribution function, simply because how we can calculate current, just like we can calculate the mass of water in a basket, right? It means the mass of the water is equal to volume times density, right? The same situation is here. We should multiply the density of states distribution function and multiply it by velocity. So we also should use this trick, which is very popular in all textbooks in solid state physics. We simply substitute the summation by integral and can calculate the current. I plus here means the current to plus direction, k plus. Please remember that we have a very tiny sample. We have here some contacts, and as I told you already, electrons do not go like the soldier during the parade, right? So there are flow of the electrons in this direction, in the direction of the applied electric field, just like we have the electrons which go against the applied electric field. So we, in order to calculate current, we can calculate I plus, I minus, and take the and subtract one from another. Subtract one from another. And in this way, we can calculate the conductance. Mu1, mu2 is not the mobility, but the electrochemical potentials, which are equal to so-called quasi-Fermi level. Why it is so? Let us suppose that we have a sample and apply here the electric field. But please remember, we have also contacts. And contacts, in most of the cases, are can be treated classically, and even have to be treated classically because they are huge in comparison with a tiny sample. So we can, within this sample, the situation is highly non-equilibrium because we have here the applied electric field. So we cannot use the Fermi distribution function. Instead of a usual Fermi distribution function, we can use something like stepwise function. But in the contacts, the electrons are in dynamical equilibrium with the environment. That is why we can characterize this gas, the electron gas here, just like the electron gas here, by means of electrochemical potentials, which are, in fact, equal to quasi-Fermi level. Why it is so? Because the electron gas here and here are a bit different due to applied voltage. We have here this formula where M is the number of modes, which are responsible for the current in this sample. Calculating I1, I2 here is. There is Landauer. It was an American physicist who, for the first time, asked the same question. Landauer asked the simple question: what would be if the length of the sample be smaller than the free electron path? So naively, we can say that in this case it would be no any resistance, but in fact, it is not. There is always resistance. Even the length of the sample is smaller than the free electron path. We call this situation the ballistic transport. It means that within such sample there is no any scattering events. But what does it mean in this case, the resistance? So resistance in this case means the resistance of the contacts. So sometimes for my student, I tell something like say something like this. Let us suppose that we have two huge halls which are connected by a very thin corridor. And there are people here, and there are people here, and we tell this to these people that there are a great many dollars scattered on the floor, and to these people we say that there are a huge amount of dollars which are scattered on the floor in this hall. And what would happen? So it would be a tumult, right? But and this is the contact resistance. But the difference is very essential. The resistance of the contact is a resistance not due to the column interaction, like the pushing by the elbow of the people, right? But it's the consequence of a Pauli principle. You know that due to Pauli principle, you know that the number of fermions is restricted in each quantized state. With respect to, if we take into account the spins, it cannot be more than two electrons in each quantized state, right? So here, within the sample, we have only a small number of modes which are responsible for the current. But in the contacts, we have a huge amount of them. So for the electrons, there are no room for the electrons to go through. Only for a few number of them. And this is the physics in the sense of a contact resistance. So we can calculate this resistance in this way, by means of a Landauer formula. What does it mean? And what was the proposition of Landauer? Landauer, please do not confuse him with Landau. Landauer. He supposed that we can describe the transport of electrons from one contact to another in terms of a probability to tunnel, or probability to transfer. And this probability is here. It is obvious that T capital should be smaller than one, than unit, and even much, much smaller than unit. And the number of modes is also not so great. That is why it's a famous Landauer formula, and you remember this factor here is due to the fact that we are dealing with a two-dimensional electron gas. And now we are able to explain what is going on in case of an integer quantum Hall effect. I would like to stress that we are dealing with integer quantum Hall effect. Again, we have the density of states within two-dimensional electron gas. These oscillations here are called Shubnikov-Dehaas oscillations. And the physics is that in case of an external magnetic field, this density of states can be represented by means of a Dirac comb, right? Dirac comb. This is the sequence of the peaks, which correspond more or less to the delta Dirac function. But please remember that the notion of a Dirac function is a very nice mathematical construction. It's not so simple. Sometimes even highly educated physicists say that delta function is something like this, which is equal to infinity which is equal to zero every way except one point, and in this point it is equal to infinity. It's absurd, absolutely, and has nothing to do with the reality. The construction is beautiful, mathematical construction, I mean, is very beautiful, and it's due to such genius as Dirac. We have such important and powerful mean as the Dirac function. But for mathematicians, it took about 10 years to construct the proper mathematical theory. Among those mathematicians which contributed to this topic was famous French mathematician Laurent Schwartz, some Russian mathematician. His name is Sobolev, if I remember correctly. And I should say that among them was also some Polish mathematician whose name is Mikulski. Okay. So the physics of Shubnikov-Dehaas oscillations is very simple. Since in the magnetic field the Landau quantization changes, so if we have Landau quantization, in reality we have some width of this level due to scattering effect, right? That is why we have no delta functions, but we have simply something like this, right? Due to scattering. So if the Fermi level is here, there is no any modes which can propagate within the sample, because no, I'm wrong. There are, but they do not contribute to the current. Okay, remember I told you already that for the current responsible only a few modes which are in the nearest vicinity of Fermi level. Only those modes are responsible for the current. So if the Fermi level is in between two Landau levels, so there is no any current, and we have zero here. But if the next Landau level is somewhere here, it means that we have a few numbers of modes which are responsible for the current, and we have peak on this curve, and we have the characteristic oscillations. So how to explain the plateaus? The plateaus in integer quantum Hall effect, it's a very interesting phenomenon, and it should be explained why we have here such plateau just in front of zeros in Shubnikov-Dehaas oscillations. I told you just a few seconds earlier that there is no any states which are responsible, which would be responsible for the current, right? So the question is, why here we have some resistivity but not the zero? This is the question. And the second one is, the plateau here is is kept with extremely high precision. What does it mean? If somebody of you makes some experiments, so you should know that in experiments, if we measure all the time some physical characteristics. We obtain all the time different numbers. There is always such oscillations, right? But if we measure here the resistivity, in this point will correspond to B1, let's say, and this point correspond to the point B2, right? If we measure transversal resistivity in these two points and calculate or measure the difference and divide this value by rho average, this ratio will be 10 to minus 6 or even smaller. What does it mean? It means that in this moment there is no any scatterings within the sample. The transport is ballistic, but at the same time, you remember, in case of an integer quantum Hall effect, the length of the sample is about 1 millimeter. So the question is, how it is possible that for so long distance there is no any scattering events within this sample? The answer is very interesting and perhaps not so obvious. So this is the cross section of the sample, right? This is the cross section of the sample. So we have the sample. This is the y direction. And what does it mean? Actually, we do not know how this potential looks like exactly. Remember, I told you that nobody knows how this potential with respect to y looks like. But the most simple model is to suppose that u versus y is proportional to y squared. So we have something like this. Yes? And it means that both sides of the sample are impenetrable for the electrons. The electrons cannot go out, right? Because there is a wall, there is a potential, right? There is a potential which captures the electron, and these are the potential with when we take into account also the external magnetic field. And look, let us look at this picture. What does it mean? It means that if the electron velocity is more or less equal to zero, better to say the k vector is small enough, it means that the in classical terms there is no Lorentz force which push the electron to the both sides of the sample, right? But if the k is great enough, it means that there is a strong Lorentz force which pushes the electrons to both sides of the sample. But in the center of the sample, we have the potential similar to this one. While near the both sides of the sample, the potential is different, right? The potential here resembles to some extent the triangular quantum well. The quantization in parabolic potential and the quantization in triangular potential looks like completely different. In case of a parabolic potential, we have equidistant spectrum, while in case of a triangular potential well, the energy difference between the levels goes up, this distance between them in energy scale goes up as n to square. So it means that if in the center there is no any modes which are responsible for the current, there are some modes on the in the vicinity of the wells, which are responsible, can be responsible for the current. These states are called edge states, and they are responsible. They are responsible for the plateau in integer quantum Hall effect. Another question is, why there is no any scattering? So, the answer is this. If we have such a sample, so in the vicinity of this side of the sample, the electrons go to the K plus direction, while in the vicinity of this wall, they go to the opposite direction. So we have two one-way roads near the borders, near the walls of the sample. And scattering event means, please remember, we have only one degree of freedom, only one component of K. So scattering events means that the electron which goes this way after the scattering event should go to the other direction. But it's not possible because let us suppose that we have here some scattering center, right? So the matrix element of this scattering event is proportional to the such integral where let it be, it's symbolic, of course. Please remember that I should show you only the physics. It's not the strict mathematics, okay? Plus K, some potential which is responsible for the scattering. Let it be some scattering center, right? And another wave function which is with respect to minus K. But what does it mean? This function, localized here, and this one, we should calculate such kind of integral, right, over the whole R space. And this, the scatter is here. This function is localized here, and this one is here. But the overlap is almost zero because wave function in many cases looks like this, right? If there is this center of a reference frame, so in most of the cases it's even the some of the axioms in quantum mechanics, the wave function goes down very quickly in order to, there are many reasons. There are many reasons for that. Okay, so this integral is practically equal to zero. That is why there is no any scatterings in case of an integer quantum Hall effect. So I skip this. Oh yes, another very interesting effect which can be used to construct different devices, quantum devices. Oh. I completely forgot to tell you that why this integer quantum Hall effect is so important, because because by means of this, first of all, it's a standard of a resistivity. And the second one, that we can measure the ratio of these two fundamental constants by very simple means. Another effect, tunnel effect, which can be used for construction of very nice quantum devices is the tunneling effect. The tunneling effect is nothing else that in case of a very thin barriers, there is some probability for the quantum object to go through this barrier. In classical physics, it's impossible. But in quantum mechanics, it's possible because... And the physics, frankly speaking, is very simple. So on the left of the barrier, the particle is free to move, right? So it's something like a plane wave. In the barrier, the wave function goes down, should decay. But on the right, it's again free to move, right? So if we suppose that there is no any scatterings within the barrier, the energy is conserved, right? But in classical physics, the energy is proportional to the amplitude square, right? But in quantum mechanics, it's proportional to the wave to the frequency, right? That is why, if we write here something like this, and then exponential decay, then after that, the wave length should be conserved, but the amplitude can be non-zero. And this is the physics of a tunneling effect. So the first device, which was developed by Nobel Prize laureate Leo Isaki, was the tunneling diode. At those times, it was the 17th of the 20th century. It was the peak achievement of the technology. That is why he received the Nobel Prize for his achievement. So the physics is very simple. The energy gap in a semiconductor is some kind of a barrier for the electrons. So if for a small values of voltage which is applied to the device, the Fermi level is here, and there is no any states which can propagate within the sample. That is why we have something like this. And after that, if the voltage goes up, the Fermi level intersect this band, and we have here such a negative part of IV characteristic. Negative in the sense that the derivative is negative. After that, we already have the characteristic just like in the classical diode. But now these devices are out of use because in order to achieve something like this, Isaki made here the document the number of acceptors and donors was so huge that this device simply degrades very very quickly in time. That is why this device now is out of use. But this effect, tunneling effect, I mean, is used in another very interesting device, which is called electron scanning microscope. The probability to tunnel depends exponentially because, and please remember that we have here a minus sign, depends exponentially on the width of the barrier. And the difference between the height of the barrier, let it be U0, and the energy of a particle. So this, due to this exponential dependence, this device is extremely sensible, and it enables to observe the atomic structure of the surface. Here, there's a so-called cantilever, and the end of this cantilever, it is called tip, contains a few atoms. So the cantilever can be can move and can be shifted along the surface with extremely high precision. If we look at this at the surface, it seems to us that they are absolutely smooth, right? But in the atomic scale, there are a great many roughnesses here in atomic scale because there are peaks, there are valleys, and the probability to tunnel is very sensitive to the distance, because this gap, I mean, here we have tip, right, and here we have surface. But in the atomic scale, remember that this surface is not smooth. So the distance changes all the time, and the current, which is tunneling current here, is very sensitive to the distance. That is why by means of this device, you can resolve the atomic structure of the surface. Of course, this is a computer modeling, a computer image. There is a special program which can transform the signal, the electric signal, to the picture. Now, instead of Esaki diet, people use the resonant tunnel. What does it mean, resonant tunnel? It's also a very interesting phenomenon. And if you have double barrier structure, and it means that here you have quantum well, the energy is quantized here. And if the energy of the electron, which is incident on the wall, on the structure, if this energy coincides with the energy of some quantization level, then the probability to tunnel through this structure, instead of the fact that we have here two barriers, I told you that even in case of one barrier, the probability decreases exponentially, right? So we can suppose that in case of the two barriers, the probability to tunnel, to transfer through this structure, is smaller than previously. But in fact, it is not. If the energy of the electron is coincided with some of them, some of the levels of energy quantization, then the probability goes up. And mathematically, sometimes it can reach the unit. It resembles to some extent the situation in optics, right? If you remember, in optics there are something like the covering with a thickness lambda over 4, where lambda is the wavelength, right? if we have such a covering on a substrate, this very thin film increases the transparency of such sandwich. It's very very similar to that. And in case of some quantization levels, we can have IV characteristic like this. See, we have here some not one peak, but many of them, and it can be used to construct a logical cell and logic circuits, which could be much faster than the than which we use today. But I tell you something about that later on during the seminar, okay? This is a picture which illustrates which I told you already. The transmission probability rises up abruptly in case of a resonant tunneling. The structure can be used to produce the quantum tunneling diode. But if we make here another quantum well, we will have double quantum well structure. Previously we had two barrier structures, but now we will have double quantum well structure, and this structure becomes resonant tunneling transistor. Maybe I skip this because of lack of time, and a few words about quantum cascade laser. A quantum cascade laser is a very useful device because by means of this we can produce the terahertz radiation, and this is a very popular topic today because terahertz radiation can penetrate the clothing walls and all that, and by means of that we can find some dangerous substances like explosive materials or weapon which somebody tried to cover by clothing, by something else. And quantum cascade laser can be used to produce terahertz generation, and quantum cascade laser is nothing else but the multiple quantum well structure, and the lasing effect is due to accumulation of the electrons on the sum of the quantum levels. After sequential tunneling, the number of electrons in one of the quantum levels becomes greater, greater, and greater, and in some moment we have the in the population inversion, just like in classical laser, and due to that we can a lasing effect. Another interesting device is a quantum interference transistor. What does it mean, quantum interference transistor? The adventure with the quantum interference transistor started not adventure with the interference transistor, but with quantum interference effect. Started by classical work by Aronoff and Baum, who asked the next question. Everybody knows that in classical electrodynamics, vector potential is very useful. Is very useful invention, right? We can treat all the electromagnetic effects and phenomena in terms of electromagnetic fields, in terms of electric and magnetic fields, but we also can treat all the phenomena in the realm of electromagnetism by means of scalar potential and vector potential. But as you remember, in quantum mechanics, what is the relation between classical physics and quantum mechanics. There are physics, of course, and there is the mathematical structures, right? Which is the relation between the mathematical structures of classical mechanics and quantum mechanics? Every physical characteristic of a phenomena in quantum mechanics we must substitute all the physical characteristics by means of operators, right? So the question which was originally posed by Aronoff and Bohm was this. In quantum mechanics, vector potential has any meaning? Can we map the such classical characteristic to the quantum picture? And they invented such kind of experiment. Let us suppose, in those times it was Gedanken experiment. Gedanken from Germany means thought experiment. But after Einstein, in many books, we call them such experiments Gedanken experiment, thought experiment. Let us suppose that we have the electron beam, and in this point, this beam is divided or is split into two, the first and the second. And let us suppose that in this point, they are merged together again. Let us suppose that we have the coil with a radius which is infinitely small. So in this case, just like in classical electromagnetism, right? The magnetic field is concentrated within the coil, right? Here, if the radius of this circle is high enough, the magnetic field here is practically equal to zero. But it's possible to show that in spite of the fact, there is a phase difference. Phase difference, I mean the phases of the wave functions. Because, you know, this path, that would be path one and path two, we can ascribe to these both paths some wave function, right? And the wave function has its own phases. The difference, the phase difference, is proportional to the flux of magnetic field. And here, phi zero capital is the flux quanta. A bit later, I'll show you what does it mean. So, using some transformations, or better to say, using the Stokes theorem, we can transform this linear integral into the integral over the surface, and easily obtain this formula. At first, many people do not agree with those authors and try to reject this explanation, but later on. The Japanese experimentalist Akira Tanamura, in very nice experiment, have shown that this effect is indeed occurs. He changed the geometry. In his experiment, the electrons go through this hole perpendicular to the plane of the picture. Okay, so this ring was made of a permalloy, but it was placed into the niobium who was kept at the temperature of phase transition, to the state of superconductivity. So you know that superconductors, not only the ideal conductors, but also the ideal diamagnetics. So the magnetic field is absent within the niobium. Why the people rejected first the proposition of Aronoff and Bohm? They told something like this. It's not possible to produce the infinitesimally thin coil. That is why we can suppose that magnetic field here and here is not equal to zero. But in case of a superconductor, the magnetic field within the hole and outside the ring is equal to zero, because niobium is kept at the Curie temperature, at the temperature of phase transition to the superconducting states. That is why the magnetic field here and here is equal to zero. Nevertheless, changing the current within the thermal oil layer, he was able to change the magnetic flux. And you can see that here we have light field, and here in this point we have black one. So we have the interference effect. And we call it quantum interference effect. And immediately after that, it was the proposition to use this effect to construct the transistor. Because putting this ring into magnetic field, we can change interference pattern. It means that in the end, we can have something like this. The flux will oscillate, but current will oscillate with respect to B. B, we can change B by means of a changing the current through the ring, and in this way we can have something like this, and it also can be used, for example, to code information, because here we have zero and here we have one, zero, one, and so on. But this transistor would have an extremely small switching energy, about 10 to minus 19 joule. It's an extremely small value, but unfortunately, such kind of a picture we can have only in a theory. In experiment, it looks like worse due to scattering effects, something like this. That is why engineers do not like such kind of a transistor. It is also the toy model. In the laboratories, it works, but in the industry, does not. The next interesting quantum effect is the Coulomb blockade. Coulomb blockade. Let us suppose that we have two pieces of metal divided by insulator. This combination of materials makes some tunneling junction, right? The question is the tunneling effect of a single electron influences the tunneling of the others? The answer is yes, but in very specific circumstances. If we make such a structure with a surface of about 0.1 times 0.1 millimeters, the change of voltage drop due to tunneling effect of a single electron is equal to this one. Because if you look at it, you can guess that this is a capacitor, right? This is the capacitor. So we can characterize this sample by means of some capacitance, and the changes of voltage drop is equal to electron charge, because we have tunneling of a single electron, over capacitance. If the surface is this, then such voltage changes of voltage drop and changes in the charging energy is absolutely invisible. It masked by temperature fluctuations, and it is not possible to observe something like this, the influence of individual acts of tunneling on the tunneling of other electrons. But modern technologies enable us to produce the pieces of material with a surface of 20 times 20 nanometers. In this case, the thermal fluctuations become so small that the tunneling effect can be visible. There is also another characteristic, which is called quantum resistance. And quantum resistance, how to calculate something like this? You remember that apart the Heisenberg uncertainty relation, which relates position and momentum of a quantum object, there is also such uncertainty relation whose physical sense is a bit different, because there is no self-adjoint time operator in quantum mechanics, or at least in standard quantum mechanics. But nevertheless, this relation exists, and we can substitute delta E by recharging energy, because we have the tunneling of a single electron, right? As for the delta T, we can calculate it by means of tunneling resistance or quantum resistance. Let it be RQ times C, right? Now, if we substitute these two formulae into the first one, so we will have RQ is equal to, let me see. No, I should multiply this these two values step by step. A to square over 2RQ, and it is equal H over 2, right? RQ is equal to A squared over H bar. Here is a bit different value, but this value, because different authors use a bit different values for RQ, but nevertheless it oscillates around 6 and 2.5 kilo ohms. And if this relation is fulfilled, then we can observe the influence of a single electron tunneling on the tunneling of the other electrons. And it reveals itself in something which we call Coulomb blockade. If we If we draw some figure here, let it be I and let it be U, the applied voltage. So normally, if we have the Ohm's law, right, we have something like this, and this is Ohm's law, which very well known from our school days, right? But in case of a Coulomb blockade, in case of a single electron tunneling, we have something like this. At first, we have nothing, and then this signal appears. And this part of IV characteristic called Coulomb blockade. It means that after the tunneling of a single electron, we should wait a bit, and after that, the tunneling of another one becomes possible. And it is in spite of the fact that in these two pieces of metal, there are a great many electrons, about 10 to 5 or even 2 to 6 electrons. But the tunneling of a single electron becomes visible. And this also can be used for in different applications, in logical schemes, in memory cells, because here we have again zero, here we have some signal, which is similar to the field effect transistor. You know that field effect transistor is the basis of contemporary chips, contemporary memory cells, and in such kind of a device, I mean field effect transistor, we also have two states, two possible states. The absence of current and the appearing of current. Here we have something like this, but we have something else. This insulator is so thin that the energy quantization arises. And due to this, we have, if the energy level in one contact coincide with the energy quantization level in this insulator, the phenomena like in the very similar phenomena like in case of a tunneling transistor appears, and we have some such kind of oscillations, which is symmetric with respect to zero, and these peaks correspond to the sequential tunneling effect due to the existence of a quantization level within this insulator, and it can be used for a single electron transistor, and this is the equivalent circuit diagram, and some explanation concerning the operation of such a device, and people believe that due to single electron transistors, we can maybe in the nearest future we can produce some computer chips with an extremely high integration level, because we have we can produce not only plain memory, but in a volume, right, three-dimensional memory. And my time is over, right? I prepared for you many other examples of beautiful devices. For example, superconducting devices, which are based on Josephson effect. But maybe later on, because our time is over. So thank you.